Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Thank you for the scripture reading, Jilly. No matter what life brings to us, no matter what happens in the world around us, the circumstances we find ourselves, we have this promise that the church is going to remain. So we can stand on that, can't we?
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Well, that's the sermon. That would be enough, wouldn't it? That would be enough. I am going to talk about seasons of life and even how they relate to seasons of the church as well. Coming up here just in a few short weeks on April 5th, Susan and I are going to get in our vehicle and start making a journey to the east for 2,400 miles. We're headed to Charlotte, North Carolina. In fact, we're going to a little town called Cramerton that sits on the outskirts of Charlotte. We bought a home there, and that's where we're going to set up the next chapter of our life, is in our new house there. I was kind of moved when I had gone through the neighborhood and driven around the small community. There's a slogan for the town of Cramerton, and it says, "Pride in our past, faith in our future." And I thought, that's really appropriate. It really felt like this is something that is an inspiring word, an encouraging word, that pride in our past, faith in our future. And that's kind of where we are even as a church right now. I've prepared a sermon that I think will be for just about everybody. It's going to be from Ecclesiastes 3, where we talk about there's a season in life. And we all go through seasons. And each and every one of us right now are in a certain stage of life, going through particular things in our life. So there's going to be something in this passage for you. Before we get into God's Word, I wanted to share a song. Every once in a while, there's a song that will make its way into popular culture that comes from the Scriptures. Well, this is one of those times. Have you got the song, Stephen? It's a familiar song for some of you.
Turn, there is a season, turn, and a time to every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh.
Sounds familiar to you, doesn't it?
Amen.
It was by the Byrds, all the way back from 1963.
Oh, wow.
It goes back a few years, doesn't it? But again, it's a popular song, and it's taken straight from Ecclesiastes 3. It's a passage that really is about reflection, about, like I say, the stages of life that we've gone through, the stages of life that we may be in, and even the stages of life that we may be anticipating as well. There are 14 different examples used in Ecclesiastes 3. These examples are opposing emotions and opposing experiences. And it kind of sets it up for you to really dig in deep and think about these things and what do they mean. The dominating notion that you see in Ecclesiastes 3, however, the biggest takeaway from this entire passage is that God has ordained the ebb and flow of all events. That God is in control, He's omnipotent, He's all-powerful. But you know, when we think of God as just being all-powerful and that His will is going to prevail, you can find some peace in that if you're a believer, but if you're not a believer, you might actually be scared by that or intimidated by that. An all-powerful God who's not only all-powerful and all-knowing, He's also a loving God. He's a good God. Didn't we sing about that earlier? He's a good, good Father. And I think it's important for us to know He's a personal God. He knows every hair on your head. He knows everything about you. And He's there at every stage of life, too. He's there for you, no matter what you're going through. I think for most of us, you know, when things are going well, that's, you know, that's great. You know, God's will and my will match up. Isn't that kind of what we pray for? Let's be honest. I know what I pray for. And in our prayers, a lot of times we do pray that way. We want God's will to match, you know, with our will, because that would be a good day for us. But are we at the place where we realize sometimes our will is not the best for us? It's not what God has in mind for us. There are times that we need to be willing to understand and go through whatever it is we're going through, knowing that God is with us and knowing that His will does prevail. So let's get into this passage. In Ecclesiastes 3, starting verse 1, it says, "There is a time for everything, a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build." And God, like I say, God has ordered these seasons. I come from a background, I grew up on a farm, an apple orchard, and you understand the seasons. When you live in a farm community, how many people have at least some background with a farm community? Anybody here? Well, a good many of them. And if the seasons don't cooperate, farming is difficult. In fact, I was just talking to my mother, because back in North Carolina, we still have apple orchard. I have about 20 acres of apple trees, so I don't maintain that. I lease it out to a man who maintains that for me. But they've had really warm weather. They've had really warm weather for February, so guess what? The trees don't really understand what's going on. The trees are thinking, hey, spring has sprung. So what do they start doing? They start to bud out, don't they? And if that goes on for a week or so, you know, the trees are going to, they're actually going to wake up to the point that they really do believe it's spring. And those buds are going to continue to form. And then if a cold snap happens, guess what? The buds are killed and there's no crop. So fortunately, they had a cold snap this weekend, which was needed. And the trees are going back into more of a dormant stage for right now. So, you know, crop failure eliminated, at least for now. But you do watch the seasons. I remember growing up and watching my father, because it wasn't just making it through spring for the buds to form and all of that, because once the fruit started forming, if you didn't get enough rain, guess what? The apples don't grow. You end up with really small apples. And then, even if you do get the rain, what happens if a hailstorm comes? Hailstorms are not good for apples. They put pock marks in the side. They look like they've been beaten up, because the hail marks will really damage an apple that's not mature. So as a farmer, you're continually watching the seasons. And I think that's why even in the book of James, you see James writing about the patience of the farmer. That the farmer learns to grow in faith and rely on God, because God orders the seasons. And he goes on to say, not only ordering the seasons, but he says there's a time to be born and a time to die. If we read the book of Ecclesiastes without understanding who Jesus Christ is and the completed work of Jesus Christ, we're in a lot of trouble. I'm born, I live, and I die, and it seems like that might be all there is, right? It's almost over, because it just seems like a human existence. But because of Jesus, the time to be born and the time to die has been changed altogether. If you look at the book of Romans, in Romans chapter 6 in particular, it talks about to count ourselves as dead to sin but alive in Christ. The real birth that we talk about is really the spiritual birth, isn't it? It's being born again. It's understanding who Jesus is and coming alive in Him as a new creation. So understanding about a time to be born, it's not really our physical birth. We saw, I guess, there's like 5 birthdays coming up this month, and that's a great thing. But do we think about our spiritual birth and celebrating that? Because that actually is the real life, isn't it? That's the true life. That's the life eternal that we have. So coming alive in Christ is really, this passage points forward to the reality of what Christ would bring. So Ecclesiastes only really makes perfect sense in light of reading what we do in Romans chapter 6. So the greatest season in our human existence is coming to know Jesus personally. It's coming alive in Him and then living with Him as Lord of our life. So Jesus is the Lord of our life in all stages. He goes on to say there's a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. So, we do go through these times of loss, time to weep, time to mourn. Those coincide, and yet a time of rejoicing, the laughter and the dancing coincide as well. They come together in times of joy. And it's remarkable to me how God works and how He orders life. You've heard the expression, the circle of life. And I think back even just about 3.5 years ago when my father died, and what a great loss that was, you know, for us as a family. But then within 3 months, I had a nephew to be born. And it's remarkable how you lose a life and then a new life comes. You know, you may have experienced this in your families as well, where someone dies, but then a child is born, and that circle just continues. And yet we go through those seasons, and we do get, our emotions do get torn. They get drawn in. And again, the emotions are not a bad thing. God created us with emotion, didn't He? So the emotions are not a bad thing, but how we react and how we respond and how we, you know, look to God and rejoice in the good times and even in the losses too. I think of how we approach even funeral services and the way that we do it now as opposed to the way maybe we did it 20 or 30 years ago. Just back in December, I was here in this same building when we had a ceremonial memorial service for Mary Terry. And I think of the rejoicing in that service and how the stories were told and sharing stories. There was a lot of laughter and there was a sense of loss too. I was just talking to Pam. Pam's Mary's daughter, and Pam works with me. And like Pam said, the hard part now is, even just a few months later, you think about all those things you wanted to ask Mom, but now you can't. You know, you can't just get on the phone and call. You just can't do that. And that's part of the loss of thinking about, boy, Mom would know. She would know the answer to this, but she's not available now because she's gone on. So we all kind of experience that. When I call my mother, it's kind of an interesting thing because sometimes I hope she doesn't answer, and I'll tell you why. Because when it goes to the voice service on the voicemail, my dad's voice is on there. My dad was giving her instruction on how to do the voice machine, which was so typical for my mom and dad. He says, first name, last name. That's my dad coming on, first name, last name, and my mom, Loretta Williams. And it's just, it cracks me up every time I hear it. But I get to hear my dad's voice, even though, you know, he's been dead now for 3.5 years. So there's still, with technology, we still can make some of those connections. So it's kind of interesting how that works. So again, there's a spiritual implication here about life and death as well, and how that our spiritual lives really are the lives that, you know, that really do make a difference. And there are people that we know who are still living in darkness. There are people in our circle, whether friends, family, neighbors, coworkers, the people that we know. And I hope that there's a bit of an angst in our heart, too, for those people who don't quite know Jesus in the way that we do. We realize that Jesus knows them and cares about them just like He does us. We realize that. But don't we want to see people come alive in Christ? Don't we want to see others to know the Jesus that we know? And so again, this time of mourning and even this time of feeling distraught, it should be a feeling that we have for those who don't know Christ, and that we certainly want them to. So as we go about our lives, both in word and in deed, that we want to share Christ with them as much as we have opportunity to. And it's always a marvelous thing. Susan and I just have had a wonderful opportunity with her cousins. We have only been reunited with them, since December maybe? Was it December we first got? She has cousins who lived up in Altadena, and the last time we had seen them was on our wedding day, which is almost 34 years ago now. And we didn't know quite why our families hadn't stayed connected. Turned out they had been Jehovah's Witnesses, so they were kind of disconnected from their end of things. And so We've gotten together with them 3 times now. I think we're going to go on a cruise together here eventually. We were planning what our next event might be, but we've kind of regained this family. And it's interesting as we're sharing notes with one another because, you know, some of our ways of thinking in the past weren't that different from how they were thinking. So not only were they shunning us, we were kind of shunning them. And now we've all come to know Jesus, and now we're all, you know, united as a family and thinking, how do we make up for those lost 30 years? And it's an amazing thing how that works. So there's a time to rejoice and a time to dance, and getting to know Susan's family. We even told them if we didn't know they were so much fun, we would have been doing this years ago. You know, but we've had a chance to be reunited. So there's a time to laugh and a time to rejoice. The next verse is an interesting one. It says a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them. Again, coming from a farm background, Susan grew up in North Dakota. Her father farmed like 2,000 acres of grain, wheat, flax, that type of thing. And it just blows my mind to think of the expanse of how much land that he took care of. He must have lived on the back of a tractor. But in those states with the cold winters like that, what will happen from the winter to the spring when it's time to till up the ground and to make ready to plant the crops, because of the way the ground will freeze and then thaw, it actually pushes the rocks up to the surface. So one of her jobs as a young girl was called picking rocks. I told her I picked apples, and she says she picked rocks. And I think, boy, that just doesn't sound like a good job at all, does it? But she picked rocks, and so each spring there would be a fresh crop of rocks that would surface to the ground. So there's a time for gathering together the rocks. One of the things that I saw in my research when I was putting a sermon together, I thought was quite interesting. This was a bit of a ritual that went on in ancient Israel. But when a conquering, if you were warring against your enemy, one of the things that would be done, and this happened in ancient Israel, but to punish the enemy, they would scatter stones on their fields. So they would do the job like what winter does in North Dakota. They would go ahead and do that to their enemies. It sounds a little harsh to do that, to scatter the stones on your enemy's field. So not recommending that we do that, but I thought that was an interesting ritual that went on during the times of war like that. This next one I think we maybe misunderstood before. It says a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away. This embracing and refraining from embracing is not necessarily talking about courtship. We use this a lot with our young people to say, okay, it's time to, we need to leave room for Jesus and the Holy Spirit in between. None of this real close dancing, none of this going on, So we actually kind of proof texted our way through this too, but it's really talking about In unison with the other verses here, it's talking about the way that we accumulate possessions and the way that we try to amass our wealth, our estate. How many of you are still building your estate? Are you doing that? It's kind of interesting in how we go about our life and amassing things. And it gets so bad at times that you can even see television shows. Have you ever watched the show Hoarders? Have you seen that? Those people have gone to an extreme, haven't they? Homes where there's just little alleyways and everything stacked to the ceiling, that's gone a little bit out of balance in that way. But there is a time that we gather, and there's a time that we throw away as well. And, for the stage we're in right now, and I think of us as a church, for those who work in the office, it's been an interesting time. If you come by our office in Glendora, if you come into my office, I have a wall of boxes. I've got 30 boxes all packed up in front of my desk. It looks like I'm in a foxhole behind my desk now. But we've been going through this process now for the last several months. And if you want to talk about casting away, you need to talk to Pam Morgan. She's been in charge of our archives and working in our warehouse and all of the work that's gone into just processing everything to be packed up and to be moved. It's been a huge, huge undertaking. I think of that being one of the examples of a time to gather and a time to cast away. And it made me think back as well to the bigger move that happened even in 2006 of moving from Pasadena and the properties we had there out to Glendora into a much smaller office and what went on there. And that was another stage of what we went through. And I was just thinking that, in this congregation, there got to be some of you who were a part of that transition too. And I think of you as being kind of the quiet, unsung heroes that helped us make that transition. So if you were in that transition in 2006 that made our way from Pasadena to Glendora, would you stand up so we can see who you are? Because I'd just like to recognize you. Yeah, Joe's in the back. Joe. Yeah. Well, thank you. Thank you for being part of that. Thank you for your dedication and keeping the church clicking along at that time. And the office at Glendora's has served us extremely well, and I'm sure Joe may even make more comments, you know, later on when he speaks to you about that. But we've been very, very comfortable, and you know, we've enjoyed the 12 years. We've been there from 2006 now to 2018, so it was a 12-year period of time. You can only imagine some of the ones who've, even Eugene Gazan wanted to know if we could move to Manila. That might be a good move for us. You know, different ones, you know, making suggestions about, you know, where the home office, you know, should be or could be. And there are many good places that we could have landed, but I see God's hand in what he's done to provide for us this office in Charlotte. It's just really the right size, has a good feel to it. International airports, easy to travel to and from, and so I hope some of you make your way out there. I would love to give you the 50-cent tour when you come. And one of the real blessings for so many of our staff, there are some who've never owned their own home before. They've rented for decades. So everybody's buying a home because they can afford a home. And right now the attitude is, oh, when visitors come, they'll just stay with us. They don't need to stay in a hotel. We'll see how long that holds up. But we will. I mean, just about everybody's going to have a really nice, comfortable home, and that's a blessing. That's really an added quality, an added value to their lives to be able to have that. So that's going to be a real blessing. So they're going to be gathering to themselves as well. But this whole process of life, and some of you may be in the middle of this too, if you're ever moving from one home to another. I mean, our house right now, Susan just said, we've been packing up over the last few weeks. She said yesterday, she said, it looks like either somebody's just moving in or they're trying to move out. We're kind of in that middle stage in between. And, you know, it's amazing as you go through and you see what you have. I had a funny experience yesterday, and one of the boxes in the garage, I actually found a gift I guess one of our kids may have given to us, and obviously we weren't using it. It was still packaged up, and it had the Marshall's tag on it. So I went by Marshall's just to find, hey, can I return this? And I could, and I think it was gifted to us like 4 years ago, but they took it back. So I thought that was good. I was casting away something that actually brought something back in return. So that was a win-win. That was kind of, I was shocked and surprised that they took it back, but they did. I think that's better than re-gifting. I'm not sure if Solomon had in mind the idea of re-gifting when he talked about, time to gather and a time to cast away. I'm not sure. We've kind of lived through some of this even with our aging parents, too, of the Susan's mom in particular, and I got to be careful talking about my mother-in-law. I understand that's a sensitive area, so I'd be very careful. But I know we've tried to help her make the transition to assisted living. That's, she really needs to be in assisted living. Everybody in the family knows that, the sisters all. And we've been trying, how long has it been, honey? 2-3 years to try to get her to make that transition. But it's hard for her because she does not want to leave her home. She doesn't want to leave her stuff. Where would I put all of my furnishings? What would happen to all of these, these things? And again, I'm not saying in a negative way, but it's hard. It's hard at what stage you go through in life. And it's very difficult for her to let go of those things. And so far, she's been able to live on her own. And that's what she's wanted to do. And we just pray for her every day that she's going to be safe. And so far, she has been. And so, she's, 80, going to be 81 years old next month. And so, please, keep her in your prayers. But maybe keep us in your prayers, too. Because sometimes as adult children, you wonder, how much of a pain you're being to your parents too. I think when I'm in my 80s, I'm probably not going to go so easy either. I think these stages of life require our patience, and that's what I kind of want to move to. In the next verses, it says a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak. And he comes back to this idea that there are times that we mourn losses, the ripping of the clothes, the sitting in silence, the sitting in the ashes. Those were all customs in the Bible when you had suffered a loss. Think of the life of Job and what he went through and how he sat in the ashes and he just sat in silence. And it said that his friends came. They actually sat in silence with him, you know, for almost a week. And then when they started talking is when the trouble began, you know. But there was something about just being with their friend who had suffered such great loss and just being there in silence suffering with him. And I think this is important for us even as a church to realize too, because the suffering in this world is a very real thing, and we all go through it at different times, even in different ways. The psychologists have identified that when you're going through grief, that there are five stages that you go through, and the stages are denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and then finally acceptance. And some of us go through those stages faster, and some go through those stages slower. But I think it's important for us as a church to understand those stages are very real. And when we have someone who's close to us, who's experiencing loss and in a state of mourning, we need to, as a church, extend grace. And sometimes that means sitting in silence, not always giving an answer. Romans 8:28 doesn't always work in the wrong timing, does it? You know, oh, get over it. You know, all things work together for those who love God. It's like, well, that's like pouring salt on a wound, isn't it? It's not bringing what's needed in the moment. So we have to be patient with people. We have to be kind and loving and understanding in that way. So it's important that we understand these things. And then it says there is a time to mend and there's a time to speak. So those are signifying that there are times of recovery. There's times of rejoicing. I know when my mom became a widow, she'd been married for 55 years. You don't go from being married 55 years and just pick up the next day and kind of start fresh. I mean, she was really grieving for at least a year, maybe a little bit longer. And she manifested it in different ways. And finally the acceptance did come. But it took time for her. It took time for her to go through that. So we have to, as a church, as Christians, be caring, be long-suffering, and be gracious. In verse 8 it says there's a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. And this might be the greatest sorting out of all our human experience. What are the objects of our attention, and where do we place not only our energy and our resources, but where do we place our passion? You know, what are we passionate about? And, you know, the extremes of war, the extremes of hate, those speak about passion, don't they? They talk about what is most important to you and what you're most concerned about. And I think for us, we're always being challenged in our relationship with Father, Son, and Spirit that we really are learning to love God with our heart, mind, and soul. I think that's what we continue to learn as we go through life. I'd written down this one statement. I think I'll just read this to you because it really spoke to me. It was challenging but also encouraging. The statement says, in this busy, noisy, crazy world — those are pretty good adjectives, aren't they? Busy, noisy, crazy world — we give so little time and attention to God. And yet when we do, we find rest for our souls. We're transcended above the noise. And we're blessed with a peace that passes human comprehension. And isn't that the case? You know, our lives are busy and crazy, and there's a lot of noise in this world. But when we quiet our spirits, when we just turn our hearts to God, what do we discover? We discover a God who's running to us. We discover a God who is there, available, all times. No matter the situation, no matter the time of day or night, God's there. God's available. And so the time to love really is now. It's to turn our hearts to God and our attention to God. And, you know, I struggle with this. I get busy in my day and all the things that I have to do, and, you know, packing up the 30 boxes in front of my desk and thinking about, you know, all the things on the other end of the country that we have to take care of. And, you know, the day just fills itself with stuff and things to do. But boy, just to quiet your spirit, to just be attentive to God. You know, do you find yourself sometimes just like, wow, Lord, look at that sunset you created. You know, just experience it and participate. And just to have an acknowledgement and an attention that turns to God. We thank God for the good things we have, because we have so many good things. Aren't we blessed above all people? And just to look at those things and to count those blessings and to share that with God in a participation. And the hate and the war, I mean, I'm not just thinking about, you know, what's happening in Syria and places around the world, Afghanistan and other places like that, but I just think about the way we have the war of words, you know, the what you see in the media. It's hard to turn on the news and not get passionate about something. It's, you know, Facebook is, you know, for me, Facebook is a place for me to see my grandchildren. That's really why Facebook was invented, so I can see the latest pictures of my grandkids. That's the most redeeming part of Facebook. But people cannot help themselves. They got to throw something out there that's divisive, that's political, that's left-wing, right-wing, and, you know, it becomes a war of words, doesn't it? And just the hate, the contention, it's all around us. It's all around us. And I think more than ever, you know, we need to be peacemakers. Doesn't Jesus say, blessed are the peacemakers? And that's who we need to be as his representatives. We've got to be the peacemakers. I try to be careful of getting drawn into some strange argument on Facebook. And even when people send me, you know, emails, and you have to try to rise above the emotion, you know. Okay, well, what's the question? I always ask when I read some emotive email that comes to me, I say, is there a question in there somewhere? You know, what is it that they just want to be heard? Do they want to know that somebody's acknowledging them? In a lot of cases, that's what most people want. They just want to be acknowledged. Sometimes they're looking for answers, occasionally. But most of all, they want to know that you know, that somebody's listening and somebody cares. That's really what people want to know. And I think that's what peacemakers do, that we're able to listen beyond the emotion, beyond the hate, beyond the, you know, the things that are so divisive, that we can rise above that. And it takes the Holy Spirit in us to do that, because that's really not our core nature, is it? I think at times it's one of those places. I was talking with Joe about all the things he's gone through in his years as the president, and boy, he went through some really stormy times, especially in the 90s, and just people so emotive at that time. And I was telling him, I in my own personal study, I've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, and I was thinking about when Jesus said, when they ask for your cloak, offer your tunic also. You know, you've got to go the extra mile with people. You've got to be willing to, you know, grace has to extend beyond, you know, just giving the cloak. You got to be willing to give them the shirt off of your back as well, because that's the world we live in right now. And that's kind of the grace that is being demanded of us in the world that we live in. If we really are going to represent Jesus, we really have to be peacemakers and people of grace. That's who we have to be. That's the season we're in. You know, like it or not, that's where we find ourselves. So in the final passage here, in verse 9 down through 13, he says, what do workers gain from their toil? I've seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He's made everything beautiful in its time. He's also set eternity in the human heart. Thank God. You know, we live in hope of eternity, don't we? That hope is in us. There's something more than this life. We're not just born and live and die and that's it. The hope of eternity has been set in our heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there's nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink. We're going to do that in a little bit. Each that they may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is a gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken away from it. God does it so that people will fear Him and honor Him. So God, who is the great Redeemer, He makes every person and every situation beautiful in its time. He is the one who wipes away all tears, who takes away all the mourning and the pain. He's the one who's conquered death. And like we said at the very beginning, He's the one who's the head of the church. So God is working out His eternal purposes in everything that He does. And we can have confidence in that. We can be encouraged by that. We can know that God is not only a God who's all-knowing, all-powerful, but is a God of love. A God who loves us, who cares about us, who whatever stage you're in, whatever you're going through. Maybe you're in a time of dancing and laughing and things are good. Maybe you're in a season of loss or mourning and you're going through grief. God is with you. Whatever stage you're in, God does not leave you. He's at each stage and every season of your life, He is there. And I hope as we continue to grow, and some of us are, you know, going through stages, it's almost like it loops around again, doesn't it? You know, the rejoicing, the celebrating, then the loss, the mourning, and then we do it again. You know, it's like we keep playing these tracks over and over. But as we go through these different tracks and seasons of life, hopefully God's becoming even more real to us, that we're understanding just, you know, the depth of how much He really does care and how much He loves us. So we will, like I say, afterwards, we do this at this church almost every week. We will eat, drink, and we will be merry, because that's what we do at Grace Life. That's part of who we are. So we'll get to do that together. But I do solicit your prayers as we do move the operations of the church, the home office, from the West Coast to the East Coast. We will have celebrated 70 years in California. 1948, I believe, was the year that Pasadena became part of the property, and from that stage on, we've been in California. So that's 70 years. That's a pretty long time. So this next chapter, I don't know how long we'll be in Charlotte. Maybe Eugene will win the argument. We might be in Manila in 12 years. I don't know. We'll see how that goes. But we're open to what the Lord has in mind, and we really are, you know, wanting His will and His best for our church. So let me pray for that, and like I say, we will eat and drink and enjoy ourselves a little bit later. Father God, we come before You. We thank You for being the God of all seasons and all stages of our life. We thank You for being with us when we're in good times and rejoicing, and even when we're in difficult times and maybe even confused and hurt and frustrated, but You are there, and You suffer with us, and You've suffered for us. And so we know that You're a personal God, and that You really do love us and care for us no matter what is happening. And we do pray as this transition happens this year with the move of the office, and it's already well underway, and we've seen Your hand in the process so far, and we just pray, Lord, that You will continue to guide the steps of all that is yet to be done, and the moving out of the office here in Glendora, and the staff members who are going across the country, and even those who are staying behind. Lord, I pray that You would help them in their next chapter of what their life is going to look like, and that it would be a new and exciting chapter. And we do celebrate the good work that's happened here in Glendora over the last 12 years. Thank You for bringing us to this place and allowing us to have this fruitful season. And we trust You, Lord, just as You've provided in the past, that You're going to be the provider for the future too. So we ask for Your blessing, Your guidance. We pray Your blessing over the meal that we're going to share together. And we thank You for giving us such variety of foods. And we thank You for not just the variety of foods, but the variety of the friends and the relationships that we have here too, Lord. You have blessed us so abundantly. We thank You, we praise You, and we do it in the name of Jesus. Amen?
Amen. Amen.